bigger houses on those smaller lots, so everything's kind of getting densified in terms of the changing landscape. And you know, coming out of that is what we mean by sustainability under the umbrella of the action plan, which is design with nature. Now, how many people heard that expression before, design with nature? Few. And it's the landscape architects in the crowd who know, right, Judith? Because it goes back to 40 years ago when Ian McCard wrote his classic book, Design with Nature. And so it's something that we've embraced and brought forward, and it'll be the theme through my presentation. So I'm a kind of guy that the glass is always half full, so in terms of the built environment, we can improve it. And, you know, most of you here being in the development industry, you know you can improve it. So if we can improve the built environment, then we can in fact protect the natural environment. That's the basic principle I'm talking to you today. And you know, about, I guess it was in 2000, I was a part of a panel at a conference called Cumulative Impacts. So we always talk about impacts. But what's the flip side of a problem? The flip side of a problem is an opportunity. So why don't we talk about cumulative benefits? And especially if you're thinking from the site level, you know, we've been conditioned for a generation to the site-by-site impacts. Well, we can turn around. That's the theme. Because benefits, just like impacts, can accrue over time. And so if we think in terms of benefits accruing over time, then the outcome is really the sustained community livability, because livability is really the key word. So that's your mind map the next half hour. Now, in terms of the water balance model, you heard a couple references. That's the new login page. So you can see the graphic in terms of integrating the site with the watershed and the stream. And actually, the old water balance models, we now call it, 2003 that we rolled that out, so it's 5 years ago. And very much a site application, where now in terms of the new water balance model, it's integrating with the watershed and the stream, because we've made a lot of progress over the last 5 years. And really, it's bringing together, again, land use planning and innovative engineering, right? So just in terms of the presentation, the two parts, you know, the first part, I want to provide a bit of a context provincially in terms of where we've come from. And in part two, I'll talk about where we're going, specifically about Vancouver Island and CAVI. CAVI, Convening for Action on Vancouver Island, remember that. I brought this quote forward because it's hard to believe it's been a decade since Patrick Condon first coined it. To get people to think about the significance of what we do at the site level, being, you know, what the cell is to the body, the site is to the region. And the other part of this slide is, you know, we're so used to talking about alternative development standards and all that kind of language, which in my view marginalizes what we're trying to do. Whereas really what we should be talking about is, what is it we want? So in terms of visualizing, in the case of Vancouver Island, what do we want this place to look like in 50 years? That's the starting point to create that vision and build a legacy. So again, as you know, as the years pass, you're able to reflect on the work one has done in the past to sort of see where we stand. And this is a graphic that we created a decade ago. And a decade ago, the crisis of the 90s was the salmon crisis. Remember that, Ken? And I was driving a lot of what we were doing. And so in terms of the salmon crisis and creating a decision tool that would help local governments in particular and councils make decisions, we talked to them at that time in terms of planning levels. And so if you look at the color coding, you know, on the red, on the left hand side being red, you know, you can't see it from where you're at, but you know, the underlying the words protect property and whatever the second one is, it's 1960s and 1980s. And that third level down, which is the image of the corridor. And so the image of the corridor is much like the canary in the coal mine. And in the 90s, the salmon was the canary in the coal mine. So, you know, going back a decade ago, things were not that hopeful, because we had a lot of, in terms of from the salmon perspective, you know, there was a lot of talk about the crisis, you know, was species at risk, extinction, you know, species becoming extinct. And so a decade ago, in terms of having a number of councils, started with Kelowna, Burnaby, Port Moody, Coquitlam, using this basic decision to agree on a 20-year vision was, well, 10 years ago, we thought if we could just hold the line in terms of loss of biodiversity and what's happened to the fish and the habitat, we'd be doing really well. And if we could be successful holding the line for 20 years, well, maybe our 50-year vision would be that we could actually improve conditions. But that was only a decade ago. And you can see from this original graph at the bottom of the, I don't have a pointer, but you see the yellow arrow pointing up. A decade ago, we we actually weren't that optimistic. We thought, you know, we really can't get much beyond holding the line in terms of the environment. Well, over the last 10 years, we're a lot more optimistic, and that's why I've shown the red arrow over here, because when you start thinking about how you develop land, there's actually room for optimism. That's really what I'm going to elaborate on in terms of why we think, and you know, what was unreachable or unachievable a decade ago is actually within our grasp. And you've got to start with the basics, which is how you develop land. And the simple way to look at it is the significance of topsoil. And having a 1 foot layer of soil on those pieces of properties that you're all developing, because it does two things. It's a sponge, right? So if you've got a sponge, and you know it holds water and better rooted plants well, in the summertime, you don't need as much water. So that helps achieve your sustainability of supply. And also if you have the sponge, you don't have as much runoff. So in terms of the runoff impacts, you know, it's supporting sustainability of your terrestrial and aquatic habitat. Bottom line is mimic the environment. The guidebook. Just kind of hold it up. This one looks like I was the principal author and project manager for this document. And what distinguishes it is that it's outcome oriented, not output oriented. Now, how many engineers are in the crowd? It's enough. So you know the typical engineering manual, right, is it's very, you know, how do I crank out a formula? You know, how do I go collect some more data, all that kind of stuff? Whereas when we did the guidebook in 2002, it was with a view to changing what we do at the site level. That was the basic objective, to change the way of thinking. And we succeeded, because expectations in this province have changed in terms of what you do at the site level. Standards and practices have changed, right? You know, that's your business. So now here we are in 2008, and here's beyond the guidebook. Now, notice this is a very thin document. It's 8 pages, I think, plus some appendices, because it's not so much the documents that change things, it's what we actually do in practice. But we have learned a lot in the last six years, so we're incorporating those lessons, and we're picking up where others left off, actually in the 90s, to change a lot of our standard practices. Now, I think the reason that Marie picked that title is because you must have come across this slide somewhere. I don't know. Because I can tell you, in 2002, when the in terms of the steering committee I reported to, when we were deciding, well, what would be the one statement that would characterize this document, that time we decided we would take the position, which was land development and watershed protection can be compatible. And in 2002, that was almost heresy, wasn't it, Ken? Because it took a radical shift in thinking to begin to translate that into action. Because the missing link in 2002 was the connection between policy and what we do at the site level. And it's hard to believe it was only a decade ago, really 1996, when Horner and Mann of Washington State published their work, that we began to get the science-based understanding that was allowing us to plug that gap between the highfalutin policy stuff and what people were actually doing at the site level. So we went back to basics, and you got to go back to basics. And we looked at the basic rainfall patterns in this province. And we organized them into three groupings, you know, light, heavy, and extreme. And what this did, because what it showed people was most of the rain in the province, and there you'll see it's the South Coast and Okanagan, and you see the pattern, you know, the blue and the red is very similar. The number of events differs, but it's very similar pattern. What this simple graphic did, it demonstrated to people that most of the rain that we get in a year falls as light showers. And you know that intuitively, but you've never thought about it. So if most of the rain is falling as light showers, then it's actually manageable. And there are literally only a handful of events where we have difficulty in managing them. And hey, when it's been raining for 2 weeks and you have the big one, it comes off, you've got to be able to convey it. But most of the time, we can manage rainfall. So that was the beginning of the shift by defining the rainfall spectrum, which is we look at all 180 events that occur in a year. And this really became, in terms of the guidebook, what defined it in terms of one graphic, which is to take that concept of the rainfall spectrum and convert it into a strategy. Because really the strategy has three elements. There's what you do at the site, there's what you do in the neighborhood, and there's what you do at the watershed level. So if you kind of run your eyes down from top to bottom in terms of the rainfall spectrum and dividing them into light showers, you know, heavy rain, and extreme storms. And I got to tell you, my wife helped me with the language on the second bullet because I think it was very technocentric the first time around. And then she said, "What the heck is, you know, whatever that is? Are you talking about light showers?" "Yes, dear." Right. So. But it starts to get you thinking about what you can do at the site. Well, at the site, you got to keep rain on site, but you can't keep it all on site. So there will be some that you have to deal with in ponds or whatever, and you got to delay that and manage that and control the rate of outflow. And then on the far right where it says, the watershed scale will reduce flooding. Well, again, when things are roaring, you got to be able to manage and contain and convey. Out of that came the recognition in terms of developing this methodology is that we needed a tool, and that's the water balance model. That's where you really wanted me to come back to the tool itself. And that was the missing link in hydrology, is having a tool which you could do things at the site scale with. So in developing this tool, it was to test the achievability of performance targets. And the performance targets, it's what proportion of the rain can you capture, right? And that's going to depend on different things. It's going to depend on your soil, on your site coverage, you know, and how much room you got to work with. But now at least people have the tool that they could begin to play with in terms of their basic site design to see how they could actually manage rain on site. And those are what we've been learning over the last 6 years. Now, how many landscape architects in the crowd? A couple? None? Okay. Because I've been saying that term from my engineering perspective, once we decide what we want to do, then I say, well, then we turn to the landscape architects and say, well, really, the solutions are basically landscape-based. And I picked this particular slide because it shows you we're on a hillside situation where people tend to build terraces and they tend to put a bit of soil there and they tend to grow things. And that's where you can manage your rainfall volume. So it's thinking like a landscape architect. So 5 years ago when we began our outreach and workshop training, this demonstration by Richard Bowes of the District of North Vancouver, we found had a huge impact on people's understanding because, as you can see in that picture there's three little transparent boxes with different amounts of soil. And just that exercise of taking a can of water, pouring the water into each of them one by one, and letting people watch what happens as the water flows through the soil, they began to say, I get it. And that's the kind of props that it takes to deal with the fundamentals. So the last 5 years, we've talked a lot about soils and people have begun to think about the importance of soils. But I mentioned before about that, having a foot of topsoil on your property. But in this part of the world, in the natural condition, trees account for interception of a good up to half of your rainfall. So when you remove the trees, you've got twice as much volume to manage from an engineering perspective. So what are you going to do? So one of the outcomes of the Water Balance Model project is a partnership that we have with UBC. And actually, the partnership involves three municipalities, the District of West Vancouver, the District of North Vancouver, and the City of North Vancouver. And we have a network of 60 stations. And I have one in my yard. You see these little piece of pipe measuring the effectiveness of tree canopy in intercepting the rain that falls. And so it's hard to believe that no one had ever done this research before. Foresters have done research on the bush, but foresters have never done research in the urban environment. So this is a North American first in terms of what's underway right now. Because you gotta get beyond the rhetoric to have the numbers. I'm just going to give you one graph for any of the technical people in the crowd, just so you get a sense of one of the preliminary results of showing the difference between, in this case, a Douglas fir and a cedar in terms of how they intercept. And you can see from this that actually the cedar is a lot more effective than the fir. But look at those numbers in terms of interception. Is it 39% and 60% interception of the amount of rain falling from the sky through that tree canopy. And so it begins to give people the science to make informed decisions in terms of what we're calling now the right trees in the right places. You don't need to protect every tree, but you got to protect the right trees to be able to achieve your rainfall volume management objective. And of course, you know, if you're on the development game, you know that the lots are getting smaller. So in terms of the available space, there isn't a lot of space to work with. So it's not realistic to think that you can solve everything on the individual property, especially when how many situations is that little rain garden at the front, that's your landscaping. So it's kind of hard to do it all there. So what that then has done in the last few years in terms of our thinking has led us to think about, okay, what do we need to do out beyond the individual lot in order to achieve the overall objectives? So Marie, I did include a technical picture. the new water balance model, very conceptually, and you can go, for those that are really keen, you can go to the right now the beta site, which is www.beta.waterbalance.ca, and you can look at all this, but basically you see the before and after. So the before graphic is really showing focus on the site, and on the right hand side where it says now, that's starting to deal with the appealing to the engineering mind. And I know there's a few people who are water balance model subscribers, like Mike Wiggle and Westbrook. And so you can just see from that slide, linking the site to detention ponds, linking it to the stream. But you know, it all comes back to, what is your soil? How much does it rain? How much of your site are you covering over with buildings or paving? And what do you got left to work with? I decided to include this slide because the pilot for Beyond the Guidebook is the Fergus Creek Plan in the city of Surrey. And the significance of this slide is, notice all that green. There's no detention pond shown. So how many of you are used to building detention ponds as part of your developments on a large scale? A few hands, right? Because in the case of Fergus Creek, and that's if you're going down Highway 99 to the U.S. border, it's the part of Surrey right before the border. So as you're heading down the border, on the right-hand side, you're heading down the border, it's 1960s type development. On the left-hand side or east side, it's greenfield. And so the strategy that came out of applying the Beyond the Guidebook thinking for this part of Surrey is a greenways-based strategy, because recognizing they could not achieve everything at the site level, there's a backbone through that watershed of multi-objective greenways to manage the volume when it rains, because most of the rain that falls is the small stuff. So just to conclude kind of the provincial context part, I threw this in because this is from a Ministry of Community Services presentation. The Ministry of Community Services is part of the this initiative, which is that today's expectations are the standards of tomorrow. So a lot of what we've been collectively proving out over the last 6 to 10 years, those have set the expectations of what people are expecting in terms of site development. And we're moving towards those becoming the standards. And this particular slide has particular relevance to those who may be in local government, because what it means is if you want the grant money, then you have to do things differently. So in terms of now focusing a bit about where are we going on Vancouver Island with the CAVI initiative, Convening for Action. How much is the time? So CAVI promotes water-centric planning. And that really just means planning with reference to water and a design with nature way of thinking and acting to create livable communities in balance with ecology. So that's livable communities in balance with ecology. I guess it must be the planner side we're talking, right, Ken? Not the engineer side. So what does CAVI do? Well, it's bringing together those who plan and regulate, i.e. local government, those who build, the developers, and many of you here today, and those who provide the legislative framework, the province. And it's really, what CAVI is doing as this virtual organization is to support organizations with a focus on water sustainability and helps them develop and share their ideas and successes so that others can see how they too can get on board. So it's very much a grassroots, bottom-up approach, which is, you know, you learn from others. A big part of it is establishing the common language, because there's a lot of buzzwords floating out there. And so we have defined a green vocabulary that is cascading. And the first one there is green value. That's a term coined by Chris Corr, who's based in Victoria. How many people have heard of Chris Corr?
Really?
Okay. This is your prize? No. And 2 minutes, okay. I'll be really fast. So green value is really, in my simplistic understanding of what Chris defines by green value, is really, it's the business case in terms of why you should do things differently and think more holistically. Design with nature is a term that resonates more with local government in terms of an application of what green value. I mean, if you design with nature, you achieve green value. Cascades down to green infrastructure, which is the policies and practices that achieve design with nature. And guess what? If you have a proper understanding of land and water use, and your practices reflect that, then the outcome is you'll achieve water sustainability because, think back to that 1 foot layer of soil and the sponge. Design with nature approach to community design means translating that smart growth language, develop complete compact communities, increase transportation options, reduce the loads and water waste and energy systems. But it always seems to come back to water, which is protecting green space. And if you strive for a lighter hydrologic footprint, guess what? You'll achieve higher levels of receiving water protection. Last year, we exceeded our own expectations in terms of launching the Creating Our Future program as an adjunct to the Gaining Ground Summit. We then organized the Showcasing Green Infrastructure Innovation Series with local governments and finished up the year with a leadership forum with the elected reps of the island. In terms of the series, you can see here the three regions, Comox Valley, Nanaimo, and Couch, and you can see the themes in terms of connecting to sustainability, design with nature. What this was an opportunity for local governments to have a platform, a venue, where they could share and showcase what they were doing other local governments and build relationships. And this has been a big part of building that networking. The leadership forum, again, it's beginning the conversation on the island about what does a positive settlement strategy mean, getting people to think about this in terms of what do you want this island to look like in 50 years. The decisions you make now will determine that. This year, in the coming months, rolling out beyond the guidebook, creating a catalog of green value practices to highlight the good things that are happening in many developments. Because the Real Estate Foundation is a co-funder of CAVI, there'll be a number of green value workshops taking place for the years out. And this year, the Showcasing Innovation Series will be CRD based with UofL, City of Langford and UVic involved. And in conclusion, 2 minutes is up. I just want to bring you back to this quote from a colleague of mine who's always reminding us about it's the people, stupid, because no matter how much we can talk about the physical things, the built environment, it still comes back to human behavior ultimately driving or determining what is sustainability. And I believe I'm on time.
Yeah.
Almost.
Thank you. Very informative information. It's great to have a technical person and to talk to us about that. I know it doesn't, it's not the big crowd pleaser with the political issues, but we sure appreciate Kim and the information, and I know there'll be more discussion of this in the future. I just want to mention one more thing, and that is we've got a lunch coming up on April 23rd, Heritage Redevelopment in the downtown. Heritage Redevelopment.